His name.
The Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and
Lord's Day, why don't we take a moment to greet each other with the peace of Christ? And some of you have colds and have a cold in your kind of hesitant, so just use an elbow.
And declare me.
We're going to do something new this morning. We have some new equipment. And I want to thank Carol for spending hours and hours researching both the screen and the projector. We need to be patient. It's coming. But we hope to be able to use this in a lot of different venues and different areas of the church at our in our missions. So enjoy this. This is the first time that it's actually been used. Now that is all set up. So if everything works right, it should sync to the computer. How about that?
And he volunteered to do this PowerPoint presentation. I'm speaking for Pilgrim Lodge. I know many of you do know how wonderful life can be at the edge of a lake in the summer. And I'm singing to the choir, to those of you who live on the lake or have a camp. But you'll agree it doesn't get much better as a place to gather with friends and swim, canoe, have campfires, and meditate by the clean, clear waters. Pilgrim Lodge is the UCC summer camp founded in 1956 on Lake Cabasacante, and it promotes all of those things and more for many ages in themed camps. It's not just for kids anymore. They started in April of this year with a jumpstart weekend and spring weekend for free using volunteers ages 12 to adult to get the camp ready. They have many theme camps, and we have brochures we hope you will take that explain them all. They have family weekends, they have vintage ventures for those of us 55 plus, they have Arts Alive for high school age artistic talents, they offer faith foundations for grades 3 through 5, one camp is simply Midler Spirit for those in middle school. One for senior high teens is Manitou Island Adventure, where they camp together to create community on the island that's in the middle of Lake Cabasacante, just offshore from the lodge. This year there's a new women's kayak adventure and a new Cabasea Explorers that goes beyond the island but uses Pilgrim Lodge as the base camp. Camp Pride is new this year too. And they have another one based on Harry Potter called Destination Hogwarts. They have added a new family weekend that already passed June 9 to 11, but you could plan for next year. There is also a grandparents and grandchildren weekend, ages 5 and older. And if you're not lucky enough to have grandchildren, perhaps a parent you know would loan you one. That would be a win-win-win for you and the child and the parents. The camp goes into the fall and late October to enjoy the beauty of the leaves turning. October 28th is the last day of free fall work day to get the place ready for winter. Now I have to tell a personal story. Teddy said I could. My oldest grandson, Teddy, went to Pilgrim Lodge for the first time when he was 11, and he fell in love with the whole experience. He went every summer after that until he was 17, and twice one summer when he was in middle school. Both his parents worked full-time, and they thought it was worth every penny. But I have to tell a little story on Teddy the first summer he went. His mother bought him all new everything, soap, toothbrush, shampoo, swimming trunks, t-shirts, and shorts, and labeled his name on everything. When she picked him up a week later, the soap was still in the wrapper. The toothbrush had not been opened. And most of the clothes were still folded in his suitcase. He had used both swimming trunks and two favorite t-shirts. His mother was horrified. Was he dirty all week? His answer was indignantly, no, I've been swimming 5 times a day in the lake. Why would I need soap? So, caution, if you're sending an 11-year-old boy, you might hint to him to open the soap and the toothbrush at least, so that he doesn't upset his mother. Please take some pamphlets and give them to neighbors or friends, working parents, grandparents, anyone who might love Pilgrim Lodge as much as Teddy did. Everyone is welcome at Pilgrim Lodge. No church affiliation is required. I put up a poster up back by the food table so you can look at a quick reference for prices. If you go a second time within the summer, you get a discount. And if you bring a friend who's absolutely new to Pilgrim Lodge for a week's camp, both you and the friend will get a discount. There are three prices given, but most people go with the lowest price. But if you have plenty of money and you want to go for the middle or the upper price, God bless you. We're putting a free will offering basket out back if you want to contribute to camper ships through missions. And as Joan mentioned last week, you can mark and strengthen the church envelope local, and that would go into camper ships too. Missions has been donating to their building project, and they just finished the new lodge. So three of us are going to tour the place this afternoon, but you can stop by any weekend when you're up near Gardner. The campers leave on Saturday and new ones arrive Sunday afternoon, so that's a good time to go in between. Teddy is now 27. His wife is ex-Army too, and she's thinking of becoming a counselor there in the future. That's another way you can go free. You can be a counselor. So Pilgrim Lodge creates a camp community in accordance with our Christian values, openness to the Holy Spirit and the grace of Jesus. So spread the word. And thank you, Michael. Happy Father's Day.
Emily used to go every single year, and senior high camp would have a habit of booking completely full in a matter of hours. So Emily and Alan and their friend, I mean, they developed friends throughout the conference, throughout the state. And they would all be emailing back and forth. It's so many hours till registration opens. And as soon as it would go, they would have parents get them signed up with a deposit. I got to boil that. And I don't see any of the kids here this morning, so we're going to forego children's message. And thank you, Carol, for all your time on securing the equipment. And who installed it?
Don Evans and I don't remember now. Don, who helped you install the equipment? Bob?
I think it was.
Bob Mikes, I think.
Wow, that.
Yes.
Thank you guys very much. And I do not see Marie here. There is one. So I am going to read the passage myself. I'm assuming he has a burning desire to read the passage this morning.
Let us be in the spirit of prayer. Holy Father, we thank you. We thank you for fathers. We thank you as a model for fathers that you have given us. We thank you that we have your word to lead us, to inspire us, to comfort us. And we ask that you would open our ears to hear what your word would say to us this morning as we read from Holy Scripture. In your name we pray. Amen. Romans is a unique book. The Apostle Paul, and a lot of people really do not like Paul's writings. Some really like Paul's. I like some, I don't like others. But the book of Romans is kind of unique because it is the only church to which he wrote
that he did not start. The Roman church was started by all those converts that were in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost. It's the only book that he is not writing to address a situation or a problem or a contemporary happening in the church at the time. He lays out the foundation for Christianity. Paul was a Pharisee, and he is very meticulous about how he presented items. And he wanted to present the Christian faith in a very succinct letter. Of course, that succinctness went on for 16 chapters. But he felt that there should be one faith, one gospel, one unified church. In chapter 1, verse 16, he says, I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of salvation to all those who believe. So we will start with chapter 5, verse 1. And those of you that have been in my Sunday school classes or my Bible studies, you're going to see where it says, therefore. And I always say, when there's a therefore there, you want to look back to see what the therefore is there for. In this case, he is going through and talking about how mankind desperately needs God, and how that we are justified by faith, and it is on faith alone that we are able to enter heaven. There's nothing we can do, because Christ did it all. Chapter 5, starting with verse 1. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace or unification with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also glory in our tribulations and sufferings, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance. And perseverance produces character. And character produces hope. Now, hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. For when we were still without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely a righteous man will die, yet perhaps for a good man, someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love toward us, in that while we were still sinners, we had not to do anything to do it. Christ died for us. May God add his blessing to our understanding of his word. Sends out the 12 apostles, and
finally, there's the New Testament reading of Romans 5, where Paul is talking about suffering and hope and justification. Then I made the comment that I didn't really like that passage because it hits too close to home. And Jan said something along the lines that it's always better to talk about something personal. Swell. So, let's take Romans 5, and we're just going to actually look at the first 5 verses. Otherwise, we'd be here an extra hour or two. Oh, by the way, I was asked, what does the sermon title mean? And the sermon title that's in your bulletin is actually a little different than what I actually came up with. But what I ended up with was suffering, faith, hope, and love, all in God's chariots. Chariots, or kairos. It's a Greek word for time. God's time, or spiritual time. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We are reconciled to him, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. That's enough. That's the first 2 verses, and we'll stop there. Rejoice in the hope of the glory of God, the end. That's it, now we'll just go on our way. But that's not the end of it. It's not the end of the text, nor is it the end of our story. It would be nice if it were. But look at the next line. Not only that, but we also glory or rejoice in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance or endurance. Endurance produces character. And character produces hope. And as I said at the beginning, sweat. This morning I'm going to share some personal points. Most of you are aware of them, but you know, my physical condition stems from what is called degenerative bone disease. It falls under the big umbrella of arthritis. That along with CRPS and RSD. Yeah, they always use these initials that you can never figure out what it means, but it's reflex sympathetic dystrophy. When I was 43, I was diagnosed with the skeleton of an 85-year-old man. Now, I know many folks have different types of remedies and treatments. Let me assure you, I've tried just about everything, including remedial legislative actions. Presently, I'm on a treatment regimen that has some amount of promise. But I bring this up this morning because I believe there are many like me who are also suffering. And that is one facet of our text. That is one facet that our text addresses this morning. We do know that the Apostle Paul was no stranger to suffering. In 2 Corinthians 12, Paul is talking about some visions that God gave him. But he did not want the Corinthians to think that he was conceited. So he writes, therefore, in order to keep me from being conceited, I was given a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. Well, we have no evidence of exactly what Paul's thorn in the flesh was. There are several speculations, including epilepsy or a condition that caused severe visual impairment. The people of the Roman church were also familiar with suffering. A little over 6 years before Paul wrote this letter, the Jewish Christians, along with all the other Jews, had been forced into exile from the city. Emperor Claudius had declared that all Jews must evacuate the city, leaving their homes, their businesses, and many of their possessions behind. And since at that time, Christianity was seen inside Judaism, that meant that Jewish Christians, along with the Gentile Christians, had to leave Rome, giving up their homes and their possessions. If you were serving Jesus, that meant you were Jewish, no matter what your nationality was. I have no doubt that there are many here this morning who are suffering right now. And you find it hard to even talk about it. You may even feel that no one really cares, or no one would take the time to listen to you. Sadly, there are some that feel that, sadly, there are many of us that know that. I skipped a line. You may feel that no one really cares, or that no one would take the time to listen to you. Sadly, there are some that many of us know that have given up on God because they feel that God has let them down, or that he no longer cares, if he ever did. Or how about those that are hanging on, hoping, just hoping, that something good may come out of their suffering. Each passing day, the doubts, the fears, the frustration become more and more the center of your mind. Still others are wondering just what they have done to deserve such suffering. The truth is, there are no easy answers. In fact, there are questions, there are more questions when it comes to suffering than there ever will be answers. There are countless books written on the subject. All I know is that suffering is part of the human condition. Some of us have more than others, but it has been that way since the fall of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. Now, in our text this morning, Paul tells us that we can see some positive things from our times of suffering. We can develop more patience, more endurance. It can help our faith to mature. It can help us place more trust in Christ. But for all that to happen, I believe that the Holy Spirit is telling us this morning that there are a couple key points about God and suffering that we really need to explore. First off is that our God is good. As we read in our call to worship this morning from Psalm 100, "For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever. His faithfulness is to all generations." Psalm 34:8, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the person that trusts in him." But those are conditional statements. We need to have faith in God. We need to trust in him. And you don't need to tell me. I know. That is hard. Moving beyond feeling sorry for yourself, for myself, moving beyond blaming God for our condition, but instead of that, choosing to have faith, choosing to trust. It's not just day by day. You know that. Sometimes it's one moment at a time. I've wondered many times how someone without a faith in God can look forward to the future. Someone without a faith community such as ours here, what helps them to hold together There are no Lone Ranger Christians. We all need each other. And while there are some great philosophies and some great ideas concerning pain and positive mental attitude, the reality is that we are in the midst, when we are in the midst of intense pain, when we are in the midst of suffering, not one of those ideas helps very much. Who cares about those lofty ideas when we're doubled over in pain, when our heart is broken in pieces, or when we are overcome with anguish or anxiety? Who cares about all that we are doing when we are doing our best just to get the next breath, to survive the next 10 minutes, or to make it through the next dark, lonely night? Who cares about all that when you can't think straight and you just wish life was over? Who cares about all that when you are battling bad, dark thoughts of merely ending it all? Now, I can only speak from my own times of pain and suffering. I can only speak about the times when the pain was so great there was just not enough medicine to stem the pain, and the only thing I could do is to cry out to God in pain, in confusion. I can only speak of when I had the thoughts that Job's wife told her husband to curse God and die. Have you ever thought about when Satan wanted to inflict the most pain and suffering on Job? Job lost his children, his livestock, his property, his money. But Satan left him his wife? Just a thought. Now, I've never seriously wanted to curse God and die, but he and I have gone some rounds with some strong words. But even at my worst, I do my best to keep my faith and remember that my God is a good God. The book of Psalms has often been a great help. Listen to the words of Psalms 56. When I am afraid, I put my trust in you. In God, whose word I praise, in God I trust, I shall not be afraid. What can mortal man do to me? Or Psalm 34. That was 34. Psalm 23, 4. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. How about Psalm 40? I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He drew me up from the pit of destruction, out of the miry bog, and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. That was written by somebody who had experienced it. There are many, many more psalms that have been of comfort. Another passage that we are charged with comes from the letter of James. Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. In recent months, I've started practicing centering prayer. It's a type of Christian meditation, if you will. No, it's not an end-all, but it does help. And praying for myself is not the only item on my checklist. In Galatians 6, we are told to bear one another's burdens. When my mind is praying for somebody else, my mind goes to them, and I spend less time thinking of my own pain, my own needs. Romans 8, Paul again tells us that God will help us, that there is maybe some good that will come out of this. Romans 8, verse 18, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. Jumping to verse 26, in the same way the Spirit helps us. This is one of my favorites. You've heard me say it before. In the same way the Spirit helps us in our weakness, we do not know what we ought to pray for.
but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And finally, in verse 28, and we know that in all things, and this is another popular one for folks, God works for the good of those who love Him and who have been called according to His purpose. The Holy Spirit praying for us, what a thought that is. It's God praying for us. There is a future glory waiting for us, and I can hardly wait. And God will use us for His good if I love Him and try to stay in His will. We also really need to remember that this is not the end. Our 80, 90, or in Miriam's case, 120 years here on earth is just a fraction of the time that we're going to be in eternity. It's nothing compared to then. And we'll be restored to enjoy life in the new heaven and the new earth. We must keep that truth in front of us. There are many times when I've been in the pit. Jen will look at me and ask if I ever listened to my own teaching and my own sermons. I think she wants to grab me and by the lapels and force me to read my own material. Believe me, I know how hard that is. Now, I'm not sharing about myself this morning for sympathy. I'm sharing to say, I understand. My suffering is probably not the same as yours. But when it comes to trying to understand the reasons for suffering, whether it be physical, emotional, psychological, or anything else, I'm here to say that God cares. Even when it is hard or seemingly impossible to handle your condition with a Christian attitude, I've been there. He cares. God did not say He will remove our sufferings, but He did give us Christian brothers and sisters to share the load with, as well as the Holy Spirit to help us throughout the day. We are reminded in 2 Corinthians 4, we have this treasure in earthen vessels, our bodies, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not us. We are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. And finally, in the last book of the Bible, God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things have passed away, and all things have become new. Thanks.
Thank you.
service where we share with each other how God has blessed us this past week. We are charged with sharing our concerns with each other, but we're also charged with sharing our joys.
I just want to thank Judy and Al for getting the bottles to the back of my car. Judy said, I have a few bottles for you in the trunk of my car. There was barely enough room for me to turn the key on to get out of the driveway.
And they're not all ours.
Judy, I've told you before, full or empty, I'll take them.
I had the pleasure yesterday of going to a dance recital, and I absolutely love them. And I also have five girls this year that dance. So afterwards, I was trying to make a quick getaway, because I had a lot to do, and made a quick exit into the bathroom, and as I was coming out, heard someone say, I think she went in the bathroom. When I came out, all five of them were standing right there waiting for me. So it was really cool.
My daughter and I went up on Rumford White Cap. It's a mountain up in the Andover region yesterday. And it was beautiful to see God's powers from that height. We ran in just like a big patch of lady slippers. I've never seen so many. It was beautiful.
Well, yesterday I found out when my son and my daughter and my grandsons will be visiting this summer, and all their plans are arranged. So I'm looking forward to that. And I received a Father's Day gift from my daughter. And my four-year-old grandson had picked all the gifts out. I got a Lego Star Wars spaceship to build, a water blaster, and a 3-foot diameter watermelon colored float for Lego. And I also found out later on that day that he asked his mom if Grandpa would let him play with those.
About 3 weeks ago, my brother and I, and my family members, bought my father a chair. He's kind of too difficult, he's helped him get up. And that was a very good Father's Day present. We gave him an advance because he's having no problems. And today, I promised him I'm going to take him to a nice, fancy restaurant for Father's Day.
Oh,
any others? Let the deacons come forward to receive our morning tithes and offerings. Invite us to hold the needs of our sisters and brothers as dear to us as our own. To love our neighbors as ourselves. We offer our thanksgivings and our petitions on behalf of all those here in this assembly. And Father, we also lift up those concerns that are heavy on our hearts that are so dear to us that we have not said them vocally. Those concerns that remain silent, we lift those before you. Holy Father, we are so grateful that we have a good God. We are so grateful that we have each other. We ask that you would be with those that are not with us this morning. Be with Pastor Richard as he continues his vacation. We ask that you would make something good come of our sufferings. We pray this the only way we can, and from who taught us to pray, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Divine presence every day. Go.